Hello and welcome to our program. Today we're continuing the discussion of the Old Testament law and its relationship to the new covenant that we are under now through Christ Jesus. There are so many of you that are still caught up in the Sabbatarian aspects of the Old Testament law, keeping the Sabbath, keeping the kosher foods. Many of the congregations call themselves Messianic Jews. That means they keep the Old Testament seder meals, the koshers, probably as far as they can, and add the fact that Christ Jesus is their Messiah. The problem is the entire book of Galatians, as well as the understanding of the apostles throughout all the ages. Their big problem, if you remember, was Judaizers, which means people who try to keep the Jewish law and yet add on to that a layer of belief in Christ as though you could do both. St. Paul makes clear that you certainly cannot. He explains in the book of Hebrews that the Old Testament law has been replaced by a better covenant. Christ takes us back to the faith of Abraham. In the book of Romans, we have that clarified, and Galatians. We are part of the seed of Abraham, who is Christ. It's in the singular. We do not need to keep the old law. The old law is meant to limit those who indeed are outside of Christ. Now, the law is a tutor, as St. Paul also says. In Galatians, we were told, we are under the tutorship of the law until we come of age, until we come into Christ and we realize his death, resurrection in our own lives, and a love relationship with Jesus Christ first. Then, only then can they understand who they are yoking themselves with in baptism. So make sure that first of all, Orthodox Christians have that relationship, whether you are a priest, bishop, or whatever. You must have that relationship with Jesus Christ as forgiver of your sin, and, as St. Simeon the New Theologian says, as the personal experience of one who baptizes you in the Holy Spirit. No one should take on any ordination, says our wonderful new theologian Simeon, unless you have experienced personally the infilling of the all Holy Spirit. Is this difficult? In a way, no, because all we do is ask the Lord Jesus Christ to send us the Holy Spirit from the Father. But is it difficult in another sense? Yes. I must first admit I don't have it. And this is what keeps many people in the Protestant world, in the evangelical world, from going further in the faith. They will stop and say, well, I've received everything. Go kneel at the feet of Christ and say, oh Lord Jesus, I need the baptism in the Holy Spirit. You have given me the sign and symbol and the reality of that. You've planted that in my heart through baptism. But now I need to enact it. I need to experience it. It needs to flow out from the inner court of my spirit into the outer court of my body. It needs to sanctify my tongue, my eyes, all of my spiritual senses. When I receive the Eucharist, I receive the Heavenly Spirit who comes down to us to sanctify all and to unify all of our senses so they will not wander like wandering sheep away from Christ. Christ calls all of his flock to himself. That means all of our senses, every part, every cell of our body, our distracted mind. We ask him to bring into one, into his fold, under his care and direction. Then the enemy cannot snatch my life, as he is ever ready to do. The old law was insufficient. The old priesthood which was part of that law, which enacted that law, is therefore insufficient. The priesthood of Aaron was fine, but the priest, the high priest, had to make sacrifices for himself. Therefore, we know the high priest was insufficient. Christ, we will see, is prefigured in the Old Testament, in the time of Abraham, before the law was interposed again, in the priesthood of Melchizedek, the king of righteousness. Tzedek is straight or righteous entirely. And we see him appearing. No doubt, many would say, in our fathers, that was the pre-incarnate Christ, taking an offering of bread and wine, as he would do in fullness of fulfillment of the priesthood in the priest Christ Jesus our Lord, our high priest, who takes that bread and wine as a sign of his self-offering that we may share. And notice what Abraham does, gives him tithes. In the book of Genesis, we can read about that. Look up Melchizedek as Abraham is returning from that battle to rescue his nephew Lot. And the Lord sanctifies that in his word by telling us through the prophet David, thou art a priest forever, according to the priesthood or order of Melchizedek, priest, high priest and king. St. Paul also says, by his kenosis or pouring out, by going through everything in our human life, of course, except sin. We see that battle of the nature of humanity as Christ, as the new Adam, the second Adam, goes into the wilderness, driven there by the Holy Spirit to face the archenemy of mankind, who hates us so much because of our relationship with God. He stole Adam and Adam's relationship and tarnished the image of God in Adam. Now the second Adam comes by his obedience to untie the knot of Adam's disobedience and to reconcile us again by his obedience to the Father, by denying the serpent, by denying Satan, by denying his anything in human nature, a pride, ambition, a presumption on the will of God, as we see in all the temptations presented. And by the way, we only see three. I'm sure there were many. Anything that humanity could be tempted by in Satan's whole lexicon of temptations, you had better believe that Satan tried our Lord, and of course he is perfect and all giving, all loving toward us, and overturned even then any work of the kingdom of darkness. He will do that now as he's on that desert and wilderness of temptation. He will complete the work by going down into the actual lair of Satan and routing him by his descent into Hades during his rest in the tomb, fulfilling the Sabbath also, by the way. The Old Testament Sabbath is entirely fulfilled by the rest of Christ from his work on the cross of our salvation, on the tree of the cross. After Abraham came Moses, remember. Pharaoh brought them under the yoke of bondage, just like Satan brings us under the yoke of bondage. We need the blood of Christ on all of ourselves to protect us and cleanse our house or our dwelling place of any sin and bondage, to protect us from death and the fear of death. So the old covenant was put into place to expose our bondage. Pharaoh was like the capitulation of all of the aspects of satanic bondage. He also signifies the future Antichrist, who will put all of the people that are beloved and all the people who are just in the world under a terrible bondage, so that they cry out to God for release, for redemption. And indeed, we are almost at that place. In fact, we are at the place of utter lawlessness, waiting to look for our redemption, first of all, because Antichrist is at our doorstep right now. Now, the Old Covenant exposed our sin, especially in the times in Egypt, under our bondage also. Christ came at his death to bring a new covenant into force. Now, we know the laws of inheritance. We know that we can't receive anything from a beloved relative until they repose, and then at their death, their inheritance laws come in to force. If they made a will previous to that, it is rendered null and void. Please remember this. The old law is rendered null and void. That doesn't mean that it was canceled out. It was fulfilled. It was rendered null and void because it's utterly fulfilled by Christ. And when we're baptized in Orthodox baptism into his life, death, passion, resurrection, now living on the other side of death, we are fulfilling the law. Now, what are the fruits of that law? We have the fruits of repentance. Let's move ahead here to the forerunner of Christ. John the forerunner, we call him in our Orthodox faith. He is the bridge between the old covenant and the new. And in John's message, the voice in the wilderness, we see what Christ picks up as his message to continue that prophetic, beautiful voice as King of all prophets, our Lord and God, and as the source of all prophecy, Christ our God. Repent and show the fruits of your repentance. John castigated the Pharisees. They were lined up, ready to go, in their robes and tassels, thinking that just by virtue of being Israelis, by being born sons of Abraham, they would come into the baptism of John, and they were therefore they would look good in the eyes of the people. John turned, pointed his finger at them, and says, "Show me the fruit of your repentance." He was hardest of all on them because they knew better. They knew the law. They knew his books and prophets. Now Christ says that no tree brings forth figs out if they're a thorn tree. If they're not a fruit tree, they can't bring forth fruit. So we see the depth of repentance in a human life by the fruits that it bears for Christ. Is there love of God? And I judge myself, first of all. Is there love of my neighbor? Is my spouse loved, cared for, embraced? Cared for in the sense of food, clothing, but spiritual and emotional needs. Am I yoked with them? Are my children part of my love for God? Thanking God for them, even if they're straying. We strayed for a time. Patience, as God is patient with us. While being firm, of course. But we need this love of our neighbor, those closest to us, and those who come into our pathway, so that we know that we love God, who is invisible. He is our first neighbor. If we don't love those we see, how can we love the one whom has bought us by a great price? How can we show our love for him except in serving his image in my neighbor and loving my neighbor as I love myself and above myself? Now, John the Baptist also, in giving that preliminary call of repentance from the wilderness, the Lord has given him a sign. As he's been in the wilderness, he hears from God. He upon whom the Holy Spirit rests without leaving is the one who is the baptizer in the Holy Spirit. That means he's the one who has the Holy Spirit in its utter fullness from the Father. By the way, the baptism of Christ is the first hint of the Holy Trinity. We have the Father's speaking, the Father's voice speaking. We have the Spirit coming as a dove so that he can be seen resting, because doves do that. We also are reminded of this picture of Genesis, where the Holy Spirit rests over the waters of creation. Christ is recreating our human nature. And when we are baptized into this eternal moment. The Jordan River becomes our baptismal font. Let's look to another picture of the old covenant being replaced by the new, and that is the outer temple and the Holy of Holies, the inner temple. We are told in the book of Hebrews, and we're about at chapter 9, outer temple is that which is carnal. That's where the sacrifices are. That's where the Old Testament lives. Only the high priest, once a year, goes with blood, that temporary blood, to the Ark of the Covenant and the mercy seat. And that blood is sprinkled there as we wait for his great mercy. By the way, between statues, representations of the cherubim that surround the throne of God. So we know whose throne it is there. But in the outer temple, the Lord calls also the temple of his body. Within is that divine nature, which we can only approach bridged through that body of his. The Lord says, I will raise up this temple, destroy it, he said to the Pharisees who would turn him over to be crucified, and I will raise up this body in 3 days. St. John, the theologian, the apostle, tells us and explains the apostles understood this later as meaning his body, the temple of his body. Now, on the cross, that flesh we see being put to rest. Voluntarily, he gave it over as a free will offering, as if you would, a voluntary offering to his Father, so that he would undo and be able to go into death and thereby split open that realm of Hades and bring up all the Old Testament saints who believed in him, who loved him. And that's why many appeared to those in Jerusalem from the Old Testament. They were going on to the heavenly paradise. The thief was there. Number one, we see him in our Orthodox icons as going in with Christ. This day you shall be with me in paradise. With this temple of his body being put to repose or death, of course not dying in his divinity, he's still with the Father, at the bosom of the Father, according to our teachings and prayers. The temple veil is rent, which hides the Holy of Holies from the carnal nature, the outer temple. So that now we see with our eyes, as the centurion saw, this is indeed the Son of God. It was rent from the top to the bottom. That means God reconciled us to himself through his Son. It's open now. We are under grace. The law, the outer court, has been destroyed by that death of the humanity of Christ, of the human nature, by the soul of that human nature going into Hades, along with the divine nature, always married, and routing Satan, raising up Adam and Eve from that loss due to their first sin, and restoring them to paradise. Can you imagine the joy, They wept outside of paradise, waiting to be restored, covered with animal skins, knowing that there would be temporary sacrifices, until they would reach that time of Christ when he would come and rescue them from the bondage to death and to Satan down in those lower regions. We enter into the Holy of Holies now, the Holy Trinity. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit are made known to us, having been made known through the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, especially the Gospel of John, the chapters 14 through 17, we are given insight into the Holy Trinity. I urge you, Protestant Christians especially, Catholics, I don't know, the Bible is still on the index of forbidden books. Throw the index away, go into the scriptures, ask the Lord for the Holy Spirit to lead you out of that church. And Protestants also, remember that Holy Scriptures is your guide, but you cannot understand Holy Scriptures with simply the commentaries of Dr. So-and-so and seminary professors such-and-such. You must have the teaching from the apostles who wrote those very scriptures and who lived as eyewitnesses to Christ. He came in time to 12 apostles as they were restored after Judas fell away, who went into the nations, the 120 disciples, all the nations preaching and teaching as God instructed them in Christ. This is the bridal feast of the bride and the bridegroom, spoken of in Ephesians 5, of course, and in the very Last Supper, so called by the West, is called an eternal supper or mystical supper by our Orthodox faith from the apostles, because we know it is ongoing. There's only one sacrifice, as the book of Hebrews says, made for sin. And then he is seated as high priest at the right hand of the Father. We enter in by faith to that one sacrifice foretold and proclaimed in the mystical supper by Christ Jesus our Lord. Now, dear friends, are you understanding that the old covenant cannot justify us? It is by grace we are saved, and yet we need to show the fruits of that grace, the fruits of that repentance, which means, as St. James says, show me your faith without works, and I'll show you my works through and in faith. We must have some kind of deeds that match what we have received. We need to act as Christ impels us to act, with love of neighbor, with going out feeding the poor, either literally or feeding the poor who don't have the gospel of Christ or the fullness of that gospel as it is in Orthodox Christianity. Now, the book of Hebrews has a treasure. It is in Chapter 12, verses 22 and following. He is describing there, our St. Paul, the wonderful fellowship that you will join into by entering into Christ's church. He says, you now have entered Mount Zion into the heavenly Jerusalem. Where is that? Where there are innumerable angels. That means heavenly. The heavens are dwelling in our holy liturgy, our divine liturgy. That's why it's called divine. We are called into the festal gathering, literally, of the saints, both in heaven and on earth. That's why we have icons around us to remind us of who is present and to call them to mind and praise God for them, for the light of Christ that's shining through and in them. He makes us perfect as we come closer and closer, as St. Paul says, from glory to glory, living, growing, never stop, searching out the will of God, especially as found in our Greek fathers, the Orthodox fathers. By the way, St. Gregory of Nyssa, who lived in the 4th century, has a wonderful teaching on the life of Moses. Many of them have teachings on Job, the Old Testament, as they bring it into the New Testament understanding, filled with the all-Holy Spirit as they are. The life of Moses is so incredible by St. Gregory Nyssa. And I will say, he has something that is really to keep in our hearts and minds about the Old Testament. He says, you will never be able to relive the Old Testament, but its circumstances, as he said, can never be relived. But we can come into the spiritual understanding of what these things meant. This is true of Passover. We don't have to relive the old Passover. It's been fulfilled by Pascha, which the idolatrous West calls by the goddess Ishtar Easter, unfortunately, which brings to light their lack of understanding of what Pascha is. It's Passover. That's Pesach in the Hebrew, that's turned to Passover, Pascha in the Greek. It means Christ's Passover from death to life, and our Passover with him in baptism. Many, many baptisms are done during this time of Easter or Pascha. So come into this knowledge through these wonderful fathers we have. Those of you who want to feel that you're in the Old Testament, go into the Old Testament understanding of our New Testament church, the Holy Orthodox Church. Then you'll understand and not just have stories about David or stories about Jonah or whatever. You'll understand that Jonah is a picture and type of the resurrection. He was spat out by the whale, so Hades spat out the, as it were, the body of Christ as he went up and raised from the dead. Come into the new, into living by grace, into the fulfillment of the law, as Hebrews 10:9 says, by the high priest of us all, the Lord Jesus Christ. May the Lord Jesus Christ bring his priesthood to bear upon us, that we may be forgiven of sin, and that we may be righteous and made righteous by his precious blood, and by going into baptism, thereby living on the other side of death with him in paradise. God bless you and keep you is our prayer.